time, but they would have access to the
what?
video. And because of the change of sign, you get a point.
Because
but it's
time,
not it's not an issue.
I'm sorry.
It's not an
I'm
issue.
Sorry,
no, no. It's fine. So I'll put this on projection now so that we'll just quickly do a bit of introduction. So I'll move away. My name is Olajide Do, so I'm not new to the community, so I'm going to just move away from this one. So Osagie has been a good friend of mine, is a senior colleague, and is someone I've known for many years now. So when it comes to Python, when it comes to machine learning, when it comes to different algorithms and a lot of things around machine learning, right? Of course, the financial engineer, apart from,
yeah.
He has a lot of things. So when it comes to doing programming, writing all of those code, Osage is a go-to person. So instead of going through all of this that I put together, this is recorded, so everyone that's watching the video later would also be able to see. So he has masters in financial engineering. He's an AI person, so he's a Python person. He's meaning that when it comes to all of this data mining, machine learning, trying to train model. So he's someone that is his field, artificial intelligence and code. So but today, by the virtue of privilege, he will be taking us on Python, just to introduce Python to. So I'm going to just move away from this slide, and then I will turn this back. So you saw, Sagi, you want to share your screen? I'll stop sharing now. I have stopped sharing. So you can share your screen and then take it away.
Okay.
It's fine.
Thank you.
So while you're doing that, everyone, please be free to ask questions. Be free to get clarifications if things are not. Osage, you will need to start from how they can install in case people have not done that deliberately. I didn't
they can
talk about that. So, but take it away, please. Go ahead. Let's ask if they have installed. My point is, I want you to start from showing that you can demonstrate how people can actually install that. I want it to be recorded. You get
yes,
the point.
Yes, yes.
So
yes, I will start from that. But
okay.
I'm not.
So if you join and there's noise around you, please mute your mic. I've muted the person. So go ahead, please, Osage.
So as I've said, can everybody see my screen?
Yes, I can see your screen. I'm seeing introduction to Python,
yeah.
5 minutes, so
yes.
I can see that screen.
Yeah. Okay. I'm going to be using this as our lecture notes on what we are going to talk about Python. This is a basic Python. What I mean by basic is that it is the beginning of Python. We are going to write simple Python codes, all those things. And we are going to show how it works, how Python works, all those things. That's what I mean by basic. By the time you are acquiring the basic idea of Python, what Python is all about, you will now start advancing to the intermediate stage, from intermediary to the advanced stage. You start using Python or whatever advanced stage. But you have to start from the basics of the shit. So this class is assumed to be for those that have little or no knowledge about Python. This is for them. So I will start. For my definition, Python is a highly leveled interpreted programming language known for its simplicity and readability. Just like any other programming language like Java, JavaScript, all those things. What I mean by simplicity and readability. At times, some programming language, you need to define a variable. You have to tell them this is a variable, all those things. But Python does not need you to define a variable. You can just, we'll talk about variable there. You can just put type Python, just write the variable at once. Python automatically knows that this is a variable. All those things. That's what I mean by Python is simplicity and it's very readable, very simple code known for Python. It's not you should code too much and write too much things on Python. All those things. That's what I mean by this definition. Though it's a high level programming language, but it's very simple and readable, all those are all things. So that's what Python is talking about. Yes, the history of Python. You cannot even talk of a Python without talking the guy that invented Python. He's a Dutch man from Netherlands called Guido van Rossum. He first released Python in 1991, all those things. And Python was designed to focus on code readability and simplicity. As I said before, and since then it has evolved over time. We've had Python 2, we've had Python 3, all those things, and the rest of this. It's just a developer, but we are at the present moment, we are using Python 3. Python 3 is being used, all those things, by the present moment. Key features of Python, how do you look at Python? How do you see Python? How is Python? What are the features? What are the things you see in Python? So see, I have talked about readability. Python is, that's, when you write the code, it's very easy for you to understand, easy for you to know all those things. And the syntax is so easy. That's why I stated this. Python emphasis code readability, make it easier to understand and maintain those things. And its syntax is designed to be clear and expressive, all those things. That we are talking of versatility of Python. Python is very vast. This is when people talk of Python these days, all those things, is the tools for data analysts. The data analysis of that tools, let's say Power BI and the rest of the things, but you still use Python to do data analysis, all those things. This is another branch called Pandas in Python. Pandas is a very good way of doing data analysis, all those things. There's also a module, all those things, a library called Matplotlib, so the library called Seaborn. These are things you use in doing data analysis, in doing your data analysis, all those things. A tools in which you will use all those things. It's also for artificial intelligence. People talk of computer vision today. Without Python, you cannot do computer object detection, all those things. Without Python, there's no AI, all those things, at the moment. But mostly AI, artificial intelligence, they build it from Python. They build everything from Python, all those things. Python is being used to build all this artificial intelligence. I don't want to dwell much on all these areas. It's a large standard. As I told you, Python is very wide. It's an open source project. What do I mean by open source? You can contribute to Python. You can write your own modules and build your own Python modules and put it out there for people to use, all those things. That's what I mean by it is a large standard that is so wide. Python is wide. We cannot even define how wide Python is at this moment as I speak to you guys. Yeah. I talked about Python 2 versus Python 3, writing Python 3, all those things. These are two versions of Python being used at the moment. But we've left Python 2, we're in Python 3 at the moment for Python being used. So what I'm going to do is that I'm going to turn this lecture note to a PDF and send to Gide. Gide can share the PDF with everybody, because most people cannot access this kind of PDF, this kind of note, without having a Jupyter notebook, all those things. Well, I'm using a Jupyter notebook to give this lecture. So I'm going to turn it to a PDF. So it will be easier for people to access to read it at any point in time. You can open your phone and if you turn a PDF, you can go through it, all these things. So, as I said, Python can be installed in Windows operating system. Windows operating system, you can use Python to install in Windows operating system. Mac, there's a Mac too. Mac operating system, there's a Python there. Linux operating system, there's a Python there also. So who has Linux? Linux is, I don't think most people know about how what Linux is all about. Obviously. It's for developer, it's for DevOps area. People want to do DevOps engineering and all this. Who like writing command line interface, all those things, using code, writing command, giving command this thing. That's what Linux is all about. So I use it, I do DevOps at times, a bit of time. Then we're talking about setting up an environment. Python, there's different type of IDE, integrated development environment called IDE. People use to write to code with Python. We have the PyCharm, which I'm going to show. I don't know. Let me just bring PyCharm up for the time so I can see. This is the PyCharm. Can people look at, can they see the PyCharm?
Yes, we can. Hello. See. You know, you're sharing your entire screen. Yes.
This is PyCharm. This is the PyCharm. Can I use PyCharm in writing your Python code? These are Python code I've written down. But these are it has to do with computer vision, all those things. For the meantime. Visual Studio Code, VS Code. This is a VS Code. This is a VS Code. I just opened it. This is a VS Code. I'm not done much on this. Can people see this is a VS Code? Can use this as a VS to write a code on Python, all those things, an IDE, all those things. Write a code. Then I'm going to talk about the last one is the Jupyter Notebook, which is what we are looking at now. This is the Jupyter Notebook. This is the Jupyter Notebook we are using to write a Python. So this is what we are going to use now. This is our main area we're going to use in looking at how Python is being used, how they run Python, what are the things Python is all about. Is the Jupyter Notebook, because it's good. It has a markdown, that means you can write on it, all those things, write whatever you feel like writing on the Jupyter Notebook, and give out to anybody you want to give out to. This is it. So we are going to go without much ado. I don't know whether I've explained much concerning what Python is all about. GD.
Okay. Before we start, any question for now, because he's going to go to practical. What he has done was to just practical. Give history and talk about how you can install it either on Mac or Windows or Linux. And he also mentioned the environment. You can write Python using Jupyter Notebook environment. You can write it from Visual Studio. There's what we call Visual Studio. You can also do on Python. That is what he has shown. But he's saying that you want to use Jupyter Notebook. So if there are questions, I'm sure people will show with the raise of hands. So I think we can proceed.
Okay. So it's very simple. I've stated how to install PyCharm on this thing. You can just, when I give you the PDF copy of this notebook, you can look at it and you can install Visual Studio Anaconda, that Jupyter Notebook on it. First of all, we are going to be talking about a simple indentation, this thing, using indentation in Python. What do we mean by indentation? Indentation is a Python is written in a form of indentation. Indentation process. Like this one now, for I in range, this thing. You see the column sign here. I cannot put, if I put the this thing in this form like this, if I run it, it's going to give me an error. Even with this self, it may not bring an error like that. But if it were to be on this side like this, depending on the indentation, let me see. You see? Depending on the indentation, Python is done in an indentation manner. That's what I want you to understand. It depends on the indentation. But if I still push it forward like this.
So just a moment, Osage. So help me break it down to say what is indentation. You get the point. So that someone would know that, okay, if you say Python is indentation, like what are you referring to?
Indentation is like a block. When you move from, you write the code from the first, like for I in range this. If you come here and just write print here, Python will give you an error this thing. It will tell you that the thing is not indented. It will give you the error, indented block. It will tell you that you have to indent it, you have to move it to a side in which Python will now say, okay, it's okay on indentation. We now print. That Python is written in an indentation manner. That's the first thing in Python. You have to write Python in an indentation manner. That's why I started
okay. With indentation. Okay, Osage, let me also cut in. You know, I always do that. Okay, so starting from, so everyone, if you look at what he put the Python basic 20 minutes, he's saying Python uses indentation to define a block. After that, there is this, let me call it a box for now, where you are seeing hash, example of indentation. That one that is with hash, Osage, what is that? Is that a comment? Is that... You get
it. Okay,
you
sense, sorry, okay.
So that people can understand. So I will need you to break everything down.
It's an ash comment. Sorry. It's a comment. Good. Sorry, gentlemen. And is there a ladies in this call?
Yes, we have. Because everything you do, Pastor, everything must be explained in details. Go ahead.
Okay. It's a comment. It's a comment. You use an ash to comment. If I do not put this ash here, there will be an error. I'm telling Python that this example of indentation is part of this coding. Python will still give me an error. See, tell me example. What is the example of indentation? Is it a code? It will still give me an error. All that's why I have to comment on it and now say, no, Python, this is not part of my code. Example of indentation is not part of my code. What is part of my code is for I in range this thing. But this is a for loop. But I just started with a for loop, but I'm not supposed to share. I just want to tell you that Python is done in an indentation manner. Everything in Python is done in an indentation manner. If you want to run a code in Python, you have to do it in an indentation manner. So I just started it. I would have started with variable and data type, but I just wanted to start. Yes, Python is done in an indentation manner. So that's what, well, I started with using a loop way, all those things in that manner. You understand? Please. That's what I started with this. Well, just to tell you that Python is done in an indentation manner. So if you run it, I looked to a range of 5. Range is part of, it's like, telling Python, say, count for me, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. But when Python is counting, Python does not count the last one, which is supposed to be the fifth one. It starts from 0. Instead of, you now say 0 is the first. Instead of saying 1 is the first. Uh-huh. So Python starts from 0. Instead of saying 1 first, all those things. We now start 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. No, there's no 5, all those things. But if you want to put 5 so, here.
Apologies, Osage, just a moment. Yes, I can hear you. You are doing very well. And I appreciate that. So let me help some people. Everyone, okay. What you are seeing in that box for high in a range of something And it's now saying range of 6 now. Now, for people that are familiar with SQL, print in this context means select. Maybe you can see it that way. Print I, what is in I? I is that, how will I put it to you now? I is for in I, there is a range. You just say help me count or help me, yes, help me select I. And that's why you are seeing 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Osage, I think you can put it in a better light with with okay. Python. So go ahead.
Okay. In the better, what I mean is that I'm counting 1, 2, 3. That's what Python is doing. And this I is what is picking out that Python. I'm using I to pick 1, 0. I'm using I to pick 1. I'm using I to pick. It's like a movement. Go, you will pick the first one, bar. You will pick the second one, bar. You will pick the I will go there and pick. The I will go there again and pick. But the speed in which he has produced the result is what you are not seeing. But what he is doing is that he's picking. He's picking 0 first, come. He's picking 1, come. He's picking 2, come. He's picking 3, come. He's picking 4, come. All those things. So that is what Python is just doing. But if you want to say you want 5, all those things, this the reason why we are doing all this is when you are into intermediate and advanced stages, you will know why we are doing all this range, all this range like this, using such things like range, the rest. But for a beginner now, just assume, yes, that's what a range is in Python. That's what a range is all about. You see. So if you want to get 5, you have to go more than 5, honestly. You produce 5. That's what it's just all about. Yeah, let me move.
So if I may say, you are trying to tell everyone that when Python is counting like a range, it starts from 0, right? Yes. Am I correct? All right, yes. Thank you.
It starts from 0. It's counting starts from 0. Anything you want to do starts from 0. Now, we're going to talk about variable and data type. I know that, I don't know whether anybody understands variable GD. I just want the class to be interactive. I don't know people's name. I don't know who to call all this. But I just want us to be interactive.
So and, please, everyone, kindly react.
Add variable and data type, all those things. GD, you understand what is called data type? You understand what it's called variable, I don't know.
Eh? Of course. So everyone, do you want to react so that it can actually help us? You just want, you know, we have different data type, you know, just like we have in SQL, just like we have in Power BI, different data types. So we also have different variables. So everyone, it would be nice if you also react so that you have an idea of maybe zero knowledge, if you don't know, so that you can be able to go maybe down one step. Or maybe take one step back and explain. So let us react.
Or should I just be explaining and just be going without the...
No, so I need... I have zero knowledge of both data
type. Anybody can talk. Anybody can talk. And just talk. Answer and talk inside the call.
And did you hear me?
Okay.
Yes, I can hear you.
Yes, I can hear you.
Yeah, so I said I have zero knowledge of both of them.
You have not done Power BI before?
No, I haven't.
Okay. And what about the rest people? They have zero knowledge too. Nobody knows about it.
Hello.
Some of us know about Power BI, but maybe we should just assume zero knowledge for the Python. But you can...
No. See, if you know, variable is variable.
Just a moment. Maybe you need to raise. Someone is saying hello. Maybe we'll need to be raising and so that we will not ignore you.
Okay.
If you are saying if you have been saying hello, please show with the raise.
You can moderate the.
Okay, so please let's show with the raise of hand if you want to react. We really want everyone to react, but if you now want to react, please let's show with the raise of hand so that we'll not ignore you. So while I'm waiting for the response, so Osage. I think we should assume zero knowledge. It's better. Reason why I said I'll bring you back so that anyone, everyone can be fine. But hold on. Adetolu, please, your hand is up. Please, kindly go ahead. You can unmute your mic, Adetolu. Adetolu Ogunleye, you can mute your mic. Your hand is up.
Sorry, please. I don't understand.
So what is it you don't understand? Just to be sure.
You don't hear of the variables and data type before.
Adetolu, are you?
I just entered and I don't really.
You just joined, so you don't know what is going on, so it's fine. Okay. Thank you. So Osagie, I will come back to you. Kindly break it down first. Okay Tunes, a moment.
Okay.
Tunes, please go ahead. And if there is noise around us, let us also mute our mic. I'm so sorry. Okay, good afternoon, sir. Please go ahead. There is that noise.
Go ahead, please. I think what trying to say, maybe as Rodrigo has said, to break down variable. Although I understand what variable is, it's like a memory location where you save items. So when you are writing the program, you give your variable name. Okay. Then also the data type is the kind of items to be saved in that inside the variable, either integer, float, read, or string. That's what the data type. Then about the looping. The looping is just like a step in maybe 5 steps to perform a single task over and over again. Then I want to say that the content of what is displaying for us is not visible enough. Maybe you can try to zoom in so that we can see the code.
It's not visible like this. I'm sharing the whole screen.
Okay, maybe you join with your phone. I guess some people join with phone. If you join with phone, you might need to zoom your phone. Because from my end, it is visible. Like it's feel everywhere. Thank you, sir, for that. I know. Just a moment. Are you true, sir? Mr. Tunes?
Yes, I'm true.
Okay, so Saga, we have to come back to you.
I don't understand much on what variable data type is so that everybody can know, as Nigeria said. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So, Osage, it still comes back to you. You need to break everything down. Just assume that zero knowledge for everyone. So, you have developed a note, but you might need to go a step backward. Don't worry about the note. The most important thing is that everyone understand everything. So please go ahead. Thank you.
Yes, let me just explain what variable is. Variable is where we store information, where you store your information. What I mean by information, you store the information there. It's like a box. You put it, you open the box and put something inside and see, this is one box. You name it. This is a box, all those things. You name it maybe X. Box, all those things. Here you store the information you want to put. And storing the information you want to put is what is called a variable. Now, variable, we have to store variable in different type of data type. That's why I explained the like S now is an integer variable, all those things. Is you should know that it's an integer. Why? It's a float variable.
So hold on. Python, what is an integer? You have
an
to.
An integer is in numerical. It's in
exactly. No, thank you. You
must okay. An integer, you is, have an integer is a numerical number. It has no point. Unlike float that has point. That has decimal place. Integer, you have no, you cannot be, you cannot call 10.0 an integer or 10.1 an integer. It's never an integer. It's a float. So also float is 3.14. It has a decimal places. So that's what the float is. Now a string is like a name of anything. You can give it John. Agnes, Jide, whatever, Akim, those are screwed, all those things.
So just again, a moment, Tosage, I'll be cutting in. So everyone with zero knowledge, don't worry, we are here for you also. He's just trying to say there are different types. Okay, let me also help by breaking it down. If you say variables, maybe see like different boxes or maybe different folders, right? Where you put some items or you put some things there. Now, Adetolu, I will answer you shortly. Then we also have different types. When you say data type, right? Data type can be like decimal. When you say decimal, it is called floater, which is like 1 point something. Anything that has remainder is decimal. But you can have quantity, like one car, two cars. You can't say 2.2, 2.5 cars. No. So that one is integer, where there is no remainder. There is no decimal. We also have what we call text, which is called string, which is alphabet. Something that is, when they say text or string, it means the name of somebody, the name of a product, the name of a vendor. It is not number. It is not also decimal. It is a text, which is alphabet. It is string. Adetolu, your hand was up. Please meet your mic and then ask your question. Unless it was an error. Osage, I think you can go ahead.
Okay, now we also have Drulumba, which is true or false. It's either you say something is true or something is false. It's called Bulim. You can write true or false, all those things. It's called Bulim in data type, all those things. Now, so that is data type, and you can give it data type a variable, all those things, too, depending. That's why I stated it. So I'm just talking about variable here. There's no result here. And what I mean by, I would like to tell you that what I mean by Python is simple and readable. If you go to other programming language, you have to define these things as variable. You put it like VR like this. You define everything as G. But in Python already know that this is a variable. Once you put an equal sign like this, equals to 10, you understand that you say S is a variable, Y is a variable, and Y is a float.
So there is a question for you. Someone said, can Boolean type be written with small letters?
No. You start with this thing with capital letter, the rest with small letter. If it's going to be false here, if we put false here, you start with F like this. F like this. You start with capital letter like this. The first letter can be capital, the rest can be small. Can you see what I've written?
Please go ahead. I'm sure the person has seen it. I'm looking at the chat you get. Go ahead.
Okay. We are going to talk about basic operations, like mathematical operations in Python. Addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, exponential, and module. I don't know whether people still remember their mathematics. Honestly. So Python has that this thing here. Ability, arithmetic operation. Okay. You take note of A plus B. First of all, you define the variable. A is 10, an integer. B is 5, it's also an integer. Now I want to add, want to do addition. A plus B, 10. A minus B, 5. So just like that, A multiplied by B, that's 5 times, 10 times 5. So Python can, obviously, immediately, if you just, you can do operation, and Python will give you all the answer. Exponential, raised to power, this thing. So this is simple Python arithmetic operation, understand? So if I run the code, you can run the code. If I run Go, you will produce everything for us. So can everybody see it? It has produced everything for us.
Yes.
Okay. Now, you can, we're talking about conversion of integer to float, from float to integer.
Okay, so there is a question for you. Why the addition written with double quotes? Don't worry, just help me answer. You know there are zero knowledge. You know what that means, inverted comma, before and after. You get the point. So yeah, that's what she's saying.
Okay, okay. Yes, addition is to show that addition is not part of our listing, our operation. It's not part. It's just to say addition, to give the, to find, you just put it to show to people that yes, you are doing an addition. This is an addition. This is a subtraction. So you must put double quotes in it as a string in order to show that yes, this is an addition. This print function, this print is a function. Inside print, you have to indicate a string inside it. So it's like it's a function on its own. So you have to indicate what is being done by using addition is close to this. When you are using print function, you will understand what print function. Maybe later I will do this and show you all the necessary things about print function.
Another person is asking something similar. I said, what do you mean by double quotation? So
double quotation.
That means, what do you mean by double quotes?
Yes, double quotes is in order to show that Python, this thing is not part of our if I remove, you will see an error being done. Yeah. If I remove this double quote here, Python will give you a fantastic error, not just an error, a fantastic one. He's asking me now. Python is telling me, what do I mean by addition? Yeah. What is addition part of our code? I'm telling Python now, no, addition is not part of our code. It's okay. Put it in double quotation for me. Let me know that addition is not part of our code. Then I have to put it in this thing for Python to see. So, yeah. I have to put it for Python to see. So if I do not put that in, Python is going to give me an error. Will be asking me, what does this addition mean? What does that addition
just to
mean?
Help? Just to help. So, Nimota and Adetolu, so you can see that one of us already helped us. Though, because you put it at the text, don't worry, me, I already understand what you mean. But in reality, when you are, my first person wrote code. Okay, no problems. So, in reality, when you want to type alphabet inside the formula, and that alphabet has to be in quotation. That is what this is saying. You cannot write Olajide, print Olajide. Olajide is a text. So if you are given that instruction, because it's a text, when you are passing a text into a formula expression, you must put it in inverted comma, double quote before Olajide, double quote after. But in this context, because addition is alphabet, right? That's why it is in double quote. I'm sure you understand, right? Someone's hand is up. Let me see. So, Dick, your hand is up. But have we answered your question?
No, my question hasn't been answered because basically the person asked the question that why is addition written in double quotes? Actually, I was confused with the quotes. But here is the thing, right? Even subtraction, multiplication, division, exponentiation, and modulus are all written in double quotes. So I don't know. Is it that addition is normally not meant to be in quotes? Because I'm quite confused.
Okay, just a moment. Okay. Subtraction is the text alphabet, Abby. Exponential is alphabet. Modulus is alphabet. But okay, Osage, go ahead. Tolu, I'll come back to you. Osage, please, let's answer Sadiq. Let's answer Limota.
Okay. I should answer that question. Okay. Now, if I do not do that, under this print statement, this print function, can you see the comma, bracket sign, I bracket it, all those things. When you bracket something like that, under this print function, if I do not tell Python that this addition is not part of what I want you to do, Python will assume that addition is part of this text addition is not part of what I want you to do. Python will
not. Osage, just a moment. Forgive me. Don't lose your line of thought. Let me help her ask this way. Is it compulsory we put addition at all in the print statement? Do you get? Can we just say print open bracket A plus B?
Yes,
maybe it's not, that is what she's trying to.
It's not compulsory. But I just,
maybe that is what she's asking.
If you want me to remove this, I will not remove it.
Please remove it. Let them see it first. They will not understand that for it. For, if it is not known, then for readability's sake. Limota, hold on, please. For readability's sake, he put that in to tell you that that actually, for zero knowledge people, is just to say this thing that this guy will do is subtraction. I know that you can see plus. Plus means addition. So if he run plus A plus, I mean, print A plus B in bracket, he will still do the work. But you want addition to come as a text. You will see that when he ran it, can you see the subtraction of 5? Because 15 is coming back now. You don't know if what he did was addition or subtraction or multiplication. But he want the text to come back. That is why, if you look at the result, you see that 15 alone is on his own. We don't know what 15 is about. We don't know if it was an addition. So the reason why he put that text in quotation is so that he can come back, so that anyone that read this thing would also see, okay, the result of 2.0 is because of division. It's just for readability's sake. Anyways, Nimota, go ahead if it is still not clear. Please go ahead.
I explained to you.
I think this person, Tunes, actually answered me, because it wasn't about addition. It was about every other thing. But I think you guys mistook my question. Maybe I asked the wrong thing. I think Tunes a little bit clear, but I'm not sure. So basically, the person that asked the question said, why the addition written with double quotes? So I'm like, is it only addition, or is this question also involving subtraction, multiplication, or is it only addition that always has to be in quotes? It's not about just addition, but it's about, the person asked about addition as though subtraction, multiplication, division, and every other one was not in quotes, but I realized they were also all in quotes. The confusion.
Okay, so I get your point. Well, I've actually answered by saying anytime you pass in text, that anytime you pass in text, it must be in quotation. Modulus is text, alphabet. Exponential is alphabet. So we are not only focusing on addition, but because she is just trying to, you know, maybe, you know, we have zero knowledge. So we are only trying to address her. But I actually said it in the passing that anytime you put letters or alphabets in a formula expression, and you want it to come back to be part of the outcome now, or the result, it must be put in inverted comma, in quotation. Are you fine now, Demota? Just to be sure.
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
We don't think so. We need to know.
To be honest, I'm a little confused. But
What's your name? Sorry.
My name is Motolai.
With time, you will be conversant with what all these things is all about. At the moment, now it may look strange to you, but with time, you now understand why we are doing all these things. You know, it's like you going to the church and they are telling you things that doesn't make sense to you.
Joseph, I'll call you now. Limota, let me come in again. I know a lot of people will also want to help you. Limota, don't move away from it, Osage, please. Don't worry. What is important is every community member, I want them to get clarification. So, Limota, let's look at it together. Print is an instruction to do something. Just see printers, bring, I know, whatever we can cover, we'll cover it. Okay. So, Limota, print is an instruction that we are telling Python to go and do something. So we're only saying Python, you know what? Do A plus. We already know what A is. Just see, do print 10 plus 5, right? But in order to put an information so that when someone is reading that, to make it readable, right? We now put, if I put print Olajide, you know what? Osage, help me put Olajide in double quotes inside the print for A plus B. Okay. Olajide will come back.
Okay.
Yes, I think you need to help me do that. So, Dimota, what we are just trying to say for readability is to say what led to 5 or what led to 15? What led to 15 is addition. What led to 5 is subtraction. We just want that to come back. It is not compulsory that we put it. It is not compulsory that we include it. So, Dimota, look at this. If you run this one now, Olajide will also come back. It will now be Olajide is 15. But my point is in calculation anywhere in database, anytime you want a text to come back in an expression or formula, you must put that text in quotation. It doesn't matter if it is addition or something. Can you see Olajide coming back? But it's not Olajide that is 15. We just want to ensure that if someone is reading, a layman will know that, okay, what that is saying. But it's not composite that we put it. Let me know if you are fine now.
Yeah, I am very fine, yes.
Okay, so Joseph, your hand was up before. Please go ahead.
Thank you.
Okay, good afternoon, Mr. Jide. Good afternoon, everyone. All right, so I just simply wanted to do a little bit of explanation, but I think you've already done that already, you know, because the first thing is to understand that the print statement simply just returns what is in the brackets. So the print statement is like a return statement.
It's
so
when you put tell you that what I did was addition A plus B. I added A plus B. That's what that statement is trying to say. What I did here was subtraction. I added A minus B, subtraction to give me 5. What I did was multiplication. Mm-hmm. I say A times B. That's 50. So that's what I just did to tell the person that this thing, this answer you are seeing, I just did multiplication from.
Yeah, exactly. So
that's what I'm trying to say. I'm not saying anything more than that.
Exactly. So I think with that, it should be more understandable that once anything starts with print, it just means give me back this exact same thing. And in double quotes, it's your variable. And then the A and B is the formula. So it's straightforward.
Yes. See, if you go to other languages like Java, you see all these things. You see what I'm doing. At times, they use some, I think, console. They'll put bracket. They'll see console. They'll use the word console. They may not use the word print. They will use the word console. They'll now write this thing out. That means produce the results. That's what they mean. They may not use the word print here. They may use the word console. That's C-O-N-S-O-L-E, all those things. So those are, that JavaScript, if you are writing on JavaScript. But if you are writing on, Python has its own, using print to print out what it wants you to see, all those things. So if you go to other languages, you will see a different thing, different from what I'm, Python is doing here, and what that word that is in that place here. You understand what I'm saying? So let us dwell on, at least, all those things. Let us dwell on this thing. Now,
so I think you can proceed. I think it's clear you can proceed.
Yes. We do what we call conversion type. Change integer to float, float to integer, change integer, mostly they change float to integer and integer to float. That's number. Anything that has to do with number. We can change from float to integer. We can also say string to, that's text. We can change it to. Like this word here, 10 is not a number. It's not, it's a string, it's a text. In Python, Python sees quotation. If you put quotation like this, Python sees it as string. It is never a number to Python. Python does not see it as a number or if you put quotation, unless you remove this quotation like this, then Python will not see it as a number. No. If we put it like this, Python sees it as a string, as a text. It's not a number, it's a text, James. It sees that number as a text. If you put number in that format, Python sees it as a text. It doesn't see it as a number. Now, if you have something like this, and Python sees it as a text, as a string, we have to remove it and make it a number. That's what I want to say. So also, we can still turn this 10, this text string, to a float too. So let me just run the code and you see what is for us to turn it. We'll put an NIT. As I told you, look at this number on that. It's a variable. As I told you, a variable stores information. Mm-hmm. So I want to tell Python, change this variable to integer and give it another, I'll now give it another name, another variable called number underscore integer. I indicated STI because at times when you are writing your variable, you have to indicate it in so that somebody who is a programmer can understand what you are doing. Can we see what sense you are making, all those things. So we say, okay, this is what I'm doing. This is what I'm doing. The person will, because it's a programmer, you understand programming language, you understand what you are saying. So we're able to read it. That's what I tried to tell you. At times, variable can be in a readability manner in which you can do it in a form of but not necessary. But if you want to do it in that manner for somebody, now I said this thing here, Python sees it as a string, it doesn't see it as a number. For us to change it to a number, we have to put an int in front of this variable and quote it and bracket it in front of this variable here. So also, if we have to tell Python, change this thing, it's a string or a text, change it to a number, to a float too. We have to put float and give it a floating string. So let me just run the code for you guys to see. Now, Python sees this thing as an integer. Let me just do something for you, show you something. If you want to know whether you are on integer or you use the type, use what you call type function to ask Python, what is this? Now, Python will answer, it's an integer. You can still ask Python again, what is this? Python will answer you, it's a float. You see, Python can tell you what it is, what you've written, and what is not written. You use the word
just type. A moment. Everyone, I hope this is clear. I hope, because he has actually explained this now. If it is clear, you can give a thumbs up for people that have zero knowledge. Because what is in that box 13 is to say that help me convert GDE to number. Something like that. Mm. So GDE is a text. So Python will understand that, okay, you still have to change this guy to this now. That is exactly the instruction he has given in that box. Int, I-N-T means integer. And because number underscore or N-U-M-B underscore S-T-R means is a variable in this context. So you are now saying, help me, and you know that that variable is 10, of course, in text. I believe this is clear, but if it is not clear, be free. Osage, please continue. If it is not clear, be free to ask questions. Osage, please go to the next one. I think we are fine.
Okay. Now, if you want to input values, you want to input values, you want people to input values from outside, you can run, you can use the word input, and you can say enter your name. You write it in this format, enter your name. The person will see it with double quote as we state all those hours. We'll use the word input. Input is like a function too. Everything we write in Python, we write function to all those things. Now, if you input number, if you use the word input, those things, Python we ask.
Sorry, enter please. Your name. Can I ask a question?
Yes.
That hello in the print function. That's hello in the print function. Wait, is it command that's supposed to be?
Yes, it's almost the same thing now where I was explaining to you. You enter that command where came before the this thing too. You remember Oragide before 15. Yeah. Anything is the same. Print for the same thing we are doing using that print function there. You understand what I'm saying?
Okay, I get it. Yes.
You understand what I'm saying? 15. Anything you can put there, you can say hi, name, whatever the thing, hi, come, whatever all those things. But this hello will be the one coming, will come there, all those things. That's what I just did. Now, this, when you want to tell somebody from outside to input their name, to input their age, all those things. I will explain. Like this one, as I explained to you, when you ask somebody to input his age from outside,
okay.
Python assumes that it is a string, as I've explained. That's why I explained what is called string and convert. Python assumes that age 45 is, it has a command like this. Like this, Python assume it that 10 is not this thing. That's why I first of all put enter your name and I bracket it with an integer here, indicating that Python, the age is that is going to put. I know that you are putting, the person is putting a string, a text, but convert that age to an integer for me. I will give you an example. Do I remove? Let us, I will show you. I will come back. Let us just run it and I will go back and show you what is happening. Operation. You see, if I don't comment on it, Python will give me an error. Tell me what is operation. Okay. Now, I'm going to enter Olajide as the name. When I enter Olajide as the name, I will press enter in my keyboard. I'll say enter age. You tell me enter my age. I'm going to enter 34 as my age. We'll now print it out. Now say, hello, Olajide. You are 34 years old. Can you see? That's what Python is saying. Now, I will give you an example.
Just a moment. Everyone with zero knowledge. Okay, good. Go ahead.
Wait,
it's fine.
I will show you something. If I do type here, I'm just going to do something here for you. Type Olajide. Olajide is not defined, so sorry. Maybe. I'm sorry, the name. It's supposed to be name, not Olajide. Name. What is name here? Because it's name that we use. What type is name? As an integer. So, age here. Now, I'm going to do something. You know why I did this thing? I'll tell you something now. If I put, remove this thing here like this, I'll run it again for you to see what I'm talking about. I'll put a gadget here. I'll put H. It will give me the answer, but it will not tell me the distance. Now, H here is not an integer, it's a string. Let me run it for you to see. Can you see? STR is a string, it's not an integer. So what Python has given to me is an integer. A stream, not an integer. So that's, I just wanted to know why that int was put in there, just to indicate, to convert that stream, which I've already explained to you on how to convert on this place here. Can never, am I understood? Or
so
there's still
Nimota, your hand was up. Unless you are fine now, maybe I answered you.
Sorry. So I'm confused. How did this stuff know the name is Olajide? How did it know the age is 34? Like, how did it get all the information?
I put it there now.
Look at the code at the top.
Where?
He asked me. Okay,
it will explain. It will explain to you. Please explain it.
You see, enter your name. This thing said, when I run this code, he asked me to enter a name. I can enter, what's your name? Nimota, whatever, or Olivia. Olivia. Age, 23.
Osagi, before you explain for me, Nimota.
Yeah.
Just a moment, I'm sorry. Nimota, let's say you are creating a form for some people, right?
Yes,
they are. Let's say they are your, maybe there is an event. So instead of creating a paper form, you can do something like this to say, anyways, if you look at that code, it is like an instruction. Just look at input output operation. You say name should be input, they need to type something. Input in this context is like a statement, is an operation, whatever you want to call it. It's an operation that will allow people to enter their name. Now, see, enter your name is a text that will show, to say, a box in front of you, and input, type something there. Osage, you might need to help me run this again. Now, okay. You can also see that age is an integer in this. You put integer in front of you, say, what they will type in the box when it comes for age. Hold on. Limota, can you see that enter your name is in front and there is a box in front?
Yes.
That text that you put in that inverted comma is the one that comes. But because there is a function, there is an operation that is called input. Input will bring something where you can type something there. Mm. Let me know if that is clear first.
Yeah, that's clear.
Don't mind, I'm laughing. So if you look at there is also input everywhere. You will need to input your name and also input your age. You now tell the guy to say, okay, when they do that, then print. Print. Sorry, someone wanted to say something. Osage, go. Take it away.
We can still put another input if you want. To talk. You can so, as many input, like what input do you want to put again? Age, name,
so
size.
Nimota, let's know if it is clear. It's just an idea. If it is clear. So after they have imputed those information at the top, those two, you now say then return or show me or bring back. So print means now show me the name and show me the age. You get the point. Anyways, Osage, go ahead. Go ahead and go ahead, please.
Hello, Osage. You are 45 years old. Now, this 45 now is no more, because it's no more a string. It's going to be an integer that changes.
So,
Limonta, are you clear? Just a moment. I'm so sorry. Limonta, Adetolu, are you clear?
Yes.
If you look at the last print, print means okay, return or show me. You see, you are is a text. That's why it came before 45. But age, you can see that age is not in quotation because age is already a variable at the top that will return 34. That's why age is not in the quotation. But if you see years old is in quotation. That's why it will also come back to say you are 45. But 45 in this context is that your integer, that your age. I hope that makes sense to you. I hope so.
I can see that your name is Usagi and you I can still bring this name and put the and just write it in a form of expression, all those things. You understand what I'm saying? So that's what Python is just about, understanding and knowing all this. I hope everybody is understanding. I'm carrying everybody along. I don't just want to carry a group of people along and the rest of you just look as if the thing is. This is not a abracadabra.
Okay, if you are following, if it's making small sense to you, please show with the raise of hand. Everyone, you know that in the community, we want to ensure everyone is fine. So that's why Osage will come back, right? Osage will come back. So if you are following show with the raise of hand, I can see, okay, thank you so much. Because once we understand the basics, right? So the next will be going to be intermediate later. So Osage, please, everyone seem to be fine. You can proceed.
Okay. Now, we are going to talk about control structure. That's what they call conditional statements. Conditional statements. What I mean by conditional statement. And we're going to write it in a form of law. If I have two variables here, x is equals to 10, y is equals to 20. Python uses an if statement. We call it an if statement. We are going to put on that condition. We are going to condition it. We are going to ask Python a condition. We are going to use greater than, equal to, less than, under conditional statement. This if statement, Python understand is an if statement. This variable here, s, we are going to use greater than. And y variable. What I'm trying to tell Python is that if x is greater than y, x, you should print that x is greater than y for me. If x is not greater than y, if x is less than y, you should tell me that x is less than y. Or x, tell me that x is equal to y, but I did not put anything that both of them are equal there. Which is 10 and 10. That's what I mean by S is equal. So that's what I'm telling Python to do for me. So if I run this conditional statement, it's called a conditional statement. Python is going to look at the condition in which you give your information, in which you are telling it to do, what you want it to do. Python, we are going to use an if, elif, and s. So we are going to write it with time. Don't look at what I'm writing, but when you start writing code, you start looking at the code, all those things, you will start writing the code in this manner. You will sit down and write the code in this manner, and you will understand why you are writing the code in this manner. If this statement is greater than y, Python will not pass here. But if this statement is not greater, Python will pass it. If it's less than y, Python will come to this place. But if it's not less than one, but if it's equal, if it's 10, Python will leave that and come to s is equal to y. So if we run this conditional, we call it a conditional statement. Try to tell us what these two variables is all about. Now, Python is telling me that S is less than Y. True or false? I don't know. You people should decide. Looking at 10 and 20.
X is less
than Y. So Python has, it did not even come to this place. Now, if I say, okay, Python, this is 10. S is equal to Y. So it's a very simple thing. Python will pass the two if and elif statement and come to the last S is equal to Y. If I say Python, S is greater than Y. Python will not even be, will not near the elif or the S. You just tell me S is greater than Y. So it's a very simple, it's a conditional statement. I'm asking Python equation. And I want Python to tell me what is happening. It's a conditional statement, condition. This is what I want, Python. We call it a conditional statement. We'll deal with conditional statement. When you are writing code, you'll deal with conditional statement a lot. You will jump some certain thing. You tell him that, okay, if this is this, print out this. If it's not, don't print anything out from that place. Leave it. If this is this, print out this. If it's not, don't print out. You write this elif. Aside this elif, you can write it several other things. Several in the Python statement.
Okay, so Sage, you have a question. What yes. happened when both variables have different data types? Someone is asking, what happens when both variables have different data types?
Data type.
So go ahead.
Let's look at what will happen when the variable. I want to show what happened when the variable. This is a float. This is a this thing. Let's ask Python. What whether it will go if they have different data type now? It will still go. The data type does not really mean anything to Python. What Python sees is that 40 is still 10.0 is not still greater than 40.40, which is an integer.
So I'm sure your value is fine. But deliberately change X to string. Change X to string.
X to string.
You it get my point. Change X to string. No, just so that people can see different. Change it to string, not float.
To string.
You know what okay, I mean? String. Yes.
Okay. If it's a string, it will not go.
Yes, but let them see it. I know it's you can't say Olajide is better than 2, but let them see it.
It will not go. It will produce an error because Python does not see float and string going. It will produce an error.
At least it's clear, just for clarification sake, so that people will know that you can't say Chioma is less than 20. So, go ahead.
Choma is less than that. Is Choma less than 20? It doesn't even make sense. So that's the Python will it's a type error. You tell you that you made a type error. So you have to come and check what error type. Where did you type the error from? That's this. I'm just as it's good that you guys have seen the error because error too tells you how to go and solve a problem. Yeah, you say it's a type error. Where have I made the type error? You start checking your code where the type error is. All this is start checking this thing because something is not making. Though Python may write it for you and say this is.
So Osage, we will round up in exactly 5:30. We'll stop, but before then you have to stop so that we can entertain questions. Like I said, you might need to come back like twice. Please,
okay.
But you can round up before so that we can take questions.
Eh? I should just round
okay,
up
everyone,
now.
If you yeah. have no, you can let me see if they have questions, but maybe you can use the next 3 minutes to tidy up.
Yes.
So that if there are questions, we can drop it in the chat. But if you want to also raise your hand, please be free. The point is, let us take advantage of Sagi so that we can ask questions.
Ask questions. You can ask me questions. How can you become good in Python? Not necessarily because of what I'm teaching. Because how can I be good in this Python? Why can I learn Python? Anytime. What is the way for me forward in knowing how to become a Pythonist? They call
so,
people who
learn Python. Are there Pythonist, questions, please? Pythonist. Let us ask questions, please. See, Osage is here, and like I said, he will come back. Can Python be used for database? That's one question for you.
Yes, Python can be used for database. Obviously. You can call Python in any database. You can write it in Jupyter Notebook and call Python in any database. And Python, you will get the database. You will get the data out of the database and you can work with it. Python can connect to a database.
Tolu, I hope your question was rightly asked. Is it what you are really asking for? Can Python be used for databases? Are you saying Python can? Okay, she said she's fine, so I'm fine. I mean, he said that's maybe you have answered. So,
yes,
any other question, please?
You write a code, there's an API that you can use to call the DC. You have to, Python has an API that you connect to the database and call the data inside the database. To answer your so far you have the permission to go into that database.
So I think Osage, you can go ahead. You still have like 11 minutes. If there are questions, we'll take it. If not, you can still go ahead. You have 11 minutes. Conditional statement is clear, I think so. We can move to loop.
Let's move to loop. Loop is like counting 1, 2. But when Python counts something, this I would have talked about. This is the list in Python. I will talk about. I will deal with that again. I'll give it because of time. We have more time. But this is the list. This thing written here is called list. L-I-S-T in Python. List. And it's a structure. It's called a structure. It's called data structure. That Python data structure is, they call it list, L-I-S-T in Python, which they usually call array in other listings, in other programming language, array. Can everybody understand? This is it. And what loop means is that you want to be counting, going inside each listing and print out everything inside. Apple, banana, cherry, all those things inside it. So if I loop, I'll show you, if I loop through this, it will print out banana, apple, banana, cherry. I'll show you. Now, you see apple, banana, and shell. It has printed out for me, telling me that using, no, this is fruits, S, many. But I say, give me one fruit, it has print banana. But if I say, I want only banana, let's see, okay, apple first, and I put 0 here. Let's see what is going to print out for me. It's going to cut everything out. It's going to cut A, B, because that's another board game entirely. It's going to cut it out in the form of A, B, C. That means it's going to bring A, B, and C in that manner for me. But that's not what we want. we'll be talking of indensing, all those type of things, but them don't go into that manner. Maybe I'm jumping too much into that area. But in terms of looping, it's going to print out each one to me out in terms of looping. You're going to print apple, banana, cherry, all those things. Even if I put another fourth one, yam.
You can put orange. Okay, it's fine.
Yam. You're going to put yam. It's going to print it in the form of for me. I don't want to go into indexing. Maybe I don't jump into it. But just looping is this is the list because I'm supposed to. Because it's looping, I'm supposed to talk about list as a structure before doing. But
okay, so there is a question for you. What if I want just cherry to come back?
Yes, if you want just cherry to come back, let's see. It's supposed to be fruits. We want to get cherry. Let's see. It's supposed to be indexing, but I don't want to go into indexing. Let's... It's not subscriptive. Okay. The print statement is not what we should do. Let's see. Okay, if you want to reach cherry to come back, is it supposed to give me? Okay. Put upcoming. Sorry, gentlemen. A code for them. If you want to reach, loop one, okay. I need to write this code if you want to reach Cherry to come back. I don't want to go writing the code again. But if you want to reach Cherry to come back, okay. We have to do what is without looping. We have to do, we don't need to loop over it. We just do what we call, let me show you something. We all do indexing. Alone. That's we just index it. We don't need to loop over it. For apple, if you say you want a banana to come, we don't need to loop over it. Is that good? We'll do indexing. But
are you fine? Has he answered you? Let's confirm.
Indexing is going to come. Answered. This is going to come later, but I don't want to jump into indexing. Eh?
Yes, she's fine.
She's fine. So we don't need to do looping over it. We don't need to loop over it. We just need to test. We want to get apple. Give us apple. We index. We move apple out. We want this. We index. That's where indexing comes. We don't need to loop. Do a looping over it for us to bring out what we want out of it. We just index. We tell it we want apple is zero, banana is one, cherry is two, yam is three. We index. So am I clear? Any other question?
No, I think she's fine.
We have 4 minutes to go.
Yes.
So let us ask question now under this 4 minutes or 3 minutes. So I will know where
so everyone, go. Please be fine to ask questions.
I will continue from the other.
Okay, next let me class. See. There is printing by position or indexing start from zero. Okay, Joseph is just reiterating for, I'm sure, reiterating for someone. So, you know, we talk about it from the beginning that Python will always count from zero. So since this is a list, so you will see apple as zero, banana as one, cherry as two, then yam as three. Please, any other questions? If there are no questions, what are the things you've learned for people that, okay, I can see messages, let me look at it. If we only want two fruits, do you use the same code? So that's another question, Sage. If you want two out of all of these fruits, how do you write it? I'm sure that's what she's asking.
Number two.
If you want two fruits, you know we have apple and banana. Maybe I want banana and yam that's to banana. Come back. That's how will I write it?
That's banana and yam or apple and banana.
Anyone? Apple. Yes, just two fruits. So Tolu,
that's slicing. That's indexing. Well, that's another topic for this indexing. So we are going to deal on indexing later. How to on that list? We are going to do on indexing. Finish. So that's indexing for you. If you want apple and banana, we don't want apple. We start from one. We want to remove apple out of it. We don't need apple. Banana, cherry, and yeah. So that's indexing. That's about indexing for now. But there is another topic. I'm supposed to put it on that list. But since it's not on that group,
So any question, any clarifications, please, what are the things you've learned, most especially the people with zero knowledge? What are the things you've learned? We only have like 1 minute or so. Please let us react. Let us put a comment, maybe a message. Let us know if this has also impacted you. Maybe you get value for this, just to be sure that it's not a waste of time you get. So if you can't unmute, and if you don't want to show with the resolver, you can drop in the chat. But if you want to unmute, please be free. We don't want to use more than, so that, we are trying to ensure maximum of 1 hour. Joseph, please go ahead. Maximum of 1 hour, 30 minutes, so that we don't rush everything. Joseph, please go ahead. Your hand is up.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. Right. Good afternoon, Mr. Asagi. Thank you very much for the class. It was a good reminder and a refresher for me. Right. So technically, I'll be looking to more and more advanced classes. And I believe that I will be able to see you again after today.
Of course.
I don't know.
That's why I said the level. This classes is for people that have little or no knowledge of Python. So with time, they will start building up. They will start knowing. But we have to do the basics. We have to just talk about basics of Python, how to use Python in different ways, those things. So by the time you are becoming familiar with how the basics of Python, you can now start writing code like professionals. You won't be asking me, why do I do this one? Why do I do that one? Why do I? No, most people will be asking questions. But professionals, if I'm to deal with professionals, people who know this thing, they won't ask me all these things. They'll just be watching. They know what to do with this. You understand? You understand what I mean? They won't ask much questions.
Thank you for that, Joseph. Any other clarification or comment? I'm looking at the timer, sorry. Don't mind me.
Okay.
But if Joseph is not done, Joseph can proceed. Okay, if there are no more comment or clarification, I will take it that just a please go ahead. If you're not just forgive me.
I just in case where there's no one has any more question or comments. Personally, what I do, just like I can always have it on the go on my phone. There's an app that I have, PyDroid. So it helps me practice, you know, when I'm on my phone and on the run. So you might want to check that out.
PyDroid. Okay. It's a good app.
Yes, PyDroid. Yeah.
PyDroid. I'll check it out. Okay. There's no problem. If it's for beginners or advanced, most of the time, Python needs to be explained to beginners. But for advanced somebody, you don't need to explain anything. You understand what you've done. All right.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Sagi. Adetolu said, when are we having this class again? We will discuss about it on WhatsApp in the group chat. I mean, in the group. We'll discuss so that we can know if it is in the next 2 weeks or you get. So we need to discuss about that so that I can communicate that to Osage. Osage will be available. He's a friend of mine. So it's a community oriented person, just like we have Paul and other people. So thank you, everyone, once again. Thank you so much, Osage. Thank you for giving us your time. And everyone is grateful that you are here. So.
Okay.
Once again, on behalf of the community, we say thank you so much.
You guys are welcome. You guys are very much welcome. We'll talk about from basic, we start talking about intermediate Python before advanced. So you'll start dealing on the usefulness of Python as time goes on. Thank you, everyone.
So on this note, I'll stop recording and I'll make it available shortly. Bye for now. If there are no comments, if there are no questions, thank you, everyone. Enjoy the rest of the day.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you again.